Good morning.
Good
morning. All right. We are delighted to have you here in worship and online. Pastor Anne is off this weekend. If you don't know it, I'm Margaret Scott, and I'm privileged to be a part of this faith community at Covenant. It's a joy to be here and to welcome everyone. Bunny, our reader today, our usual tech team, and Kevin and his crew here also to lead you in worship. We're going to do something just a wee bit different this morning as part of our call to worship. So as Kevin plays the musical prelude, I want you to think about this. Finish this sentence. If it had not been for God who was for us. Okay? Finish that sentence during, think about that. If it was not God who had been for us. If you watched our Wednesday reflection, I know you've come already prepared with an answer to that. The question comes from Psalm 124, which begins that way. It's a community thanksgiving psalm, and it starts out, if it had not been that God was for us, let everybody now say, if it was not that God had been for us, and then it goes on into a litany of how much worse it could have been, but that's another whole story. So during our call to worship, you will have an opportunity to add your own out loud in our communal worship here and online. For example, you can use a personal example or a communal example, a community example. You could, but a couple of examples. If it had not been for God being for us, I'd still be trying to run my own life. If it had not been for God being for us, Covenant Church wouldn't be our spiritual home. We wouldn't need a spiritual home. And I want to share one that came from a reading this week, a daily reflection this week. As we grew, we discovered the best possible source of emotional stability to be God. Dependence on God's justice, forgiveness, and love was healthy, and it would work where nothing else would. If we really depended on God, we wouldn't very well play God for others, and it is only a loving God who can give us inner peace. If it had not been for God who was for us. As we hear the music, let us settle our hearts, our minds, our bodies, and ponder if it had not been thank you.
Please join me in the responsive call to worship based on Psalm 124. If it had not been for God, if it had not been for God, we would not be here. If it had not been for God, if it had not been for God, we would not sing praises. If it had not been for God, if it had not been for God, we would be overwhelmed by life. If it had not been for God, if it had not been for God, we wouldn't exist. I would be one of Satan's puppets.
My family would be estranged.
My family would be estranged. I wouldn't have faith. I would be dead. I would be alone. I would have no hope. I would not have my loving marriage. Thank you. Thanks be to God. Our help is in the name of God, maker of heaven and earth, giver of amazing grace. Amen. For our hymn, Grace Alone. For our prayer of illumination. Lord, open our hearts and minds by the power of your Holy Spirit, that as the scriptures are read and your word proclaimed, we may hear with joy what you say to us today. Amen. Our reading today will be from Matthew chapter 16, verses 13 through 20. When Jesus came to the region of Caesarea Philippi, he asked his disciples, "Who do people say that the Son of Man is?" "Well," they replied, "some say John the Baptist, some say Elijah, and others say Jeremiah or one of the other prophets." Then he asked them, "But who do you say I am?" Simon Peter answered, "You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God." Jesus replied, "You are blessed, Simon, son of John, because my Father in heaven has revealed this to you. You did not learn this from any human being. Now I say to you that you are Peter," which means rock, "and upon this rock I will build my church, and all the powers of hell will not conquer it. And I will give you the keys of the kingdom of heaven. Whatever you forbid on earth will be forbidden in heaven, and whatever you permit on earth will be permitted in heaven." Then he sternly warned the disciples not to tell anyone that he was the Messiah. Thanks be to God.
Please be seated. It's a little intimidating to have to preach for Anne, because she has always great quotes from learned scholars. And I want to start with a television example. This past week I admit I can be a scroller. I came across a recent episode of a program called Expedition Unknown. It's hosted by somebody called Josh Gates, who says he's an archaeology degree, but he's really an explorer. And this episode, he was in Israel, and he was searching for what he called the lost city of the Gospels, Bethsaida. And it turns out there are multiple archaeological sites that claim this is Bethsaida. But at the end of the program, he ends up in this place called Caesarea Philippi, the setting of today's story. Caesarea Philippi was a busy Roman city on a busy Roman trade route, and was a pilgrimage center for worship of the god Pan. Now, in this photograph that some of you can see if you're in the sanctuary, you will see a river in front and then a cliff behind and a big hole in the cliff. That is what is known as the Grotto of Pan. Apparently, the Romans in their day decided that that was where Pan was to be worshipped. And the whole grotto was known as the entrance to the underworld. Around this whole setting, covering up the cave, would in fact have been temples and statues with lots of pilgrims coming to visit this particular spot. And you'd go through the temple, and you would come out and see the inside of this grotto, which had water on the base, kept level always by Roman engineering, which is amazing. And out of the middle of that cave floor, out of that water, there stood a large rock. And they think that probably there was a statue of Pan on top of it, okay? Now, it's all dried up now, and the ruins of the ancient pagan temples are all around this site because it's gone now. And I want you to hold that image, that picture, that era, in your mind as we think about this conversation between Jesus and his disciples and then Jesus and Peter. It's in Caesarea Philippi where Jesus has this back and forth conversation, first of all, with those disciples about what people were saying about him. And it's actually in a present participle. It's not who do people say that I am, it's what are people saying about me? Who are they saying I am? It's like, you know, what's the scoop, guys? You know, tell us what's going on here. And who are people saying I am? And then he asks a tougher question for us disciples today. And what about you? When you hear the chat about me, what are you saying? Ooh, that's worth thinking about. That's a kind of a key question. And I think when I hear Peter answer with this very definite, you know, some people say, the first guys are all saying, well, some people say this and some people say that. And Peter, you know Peter, strong and impulsive to the end, answers this certain statement of faith. You are the Messiah, the Son of the living God. Now, I could stop right there. Because that question, who are you saying in the midst of your chit-chat around the world about Jesus, and there's plenty of it because there's a lot of Christian identification with a lot of politics these days. Who are you saying that I am? And if you like that question and you want to ponder that a little, you have my permission to tune me out completely and think about that for the next few minutes. But there's an awful lot in this text that just still challenges us. And half of it I'm not even going to tackle. If you are a thinker, if you're sort of a head kind of person, you like information. You like background information. You like to know more. You like this stuff about, oh, what's the archaeological setting of this story? Unfortunately, for a lot of us who are head people, we allow it to stay in our heads and we gather all this information. And we think we're engaging with the text when, in fact, unless we're a biblical scholar, we're really just staying up here and not letting it go down about 12 inches into the heart and the soul of our whole, the depths of our lives. But it can also be an entry point. So the question of who do you say I am is one of those questions that goes right here. But for thinkers, it stays up here a while and you play around with it. And then you want more information. And then it can become that entry point, we hope, when it'll go down about 12 inches. So let's think about words and places and word play on this word, rock. Jesus nicknames Simon after his very, very clear for Simon, who never is clear about anything, declaration of who Jesus is. And Jesus recognizes that, oh, maybe there's hope for this guy, you know? He's listening to God. God has revealed this to him, and he's listening. So maybe there's some hope for him. And he says, you know what? I'm going to start calling you Rocky. Your name's going to be Peter, which means rock in Greek. In Aramaic, he'd be called Cephas or Cephas, which also means rock. And Jesus says to him, you're going to be the foundation, the rock on which the church is built. Now the church is not probably a Jesus word. It's very rare that Jesus uses that word. Probably it's Matthew's use of Jesus' mouth to say that word, because in Jesus' day, he had no intention of starting something new. He was there to get the people, his own people, to be renewed themselves. The church, in fact, was a movement. It was just a bunch of guys and women, let's not forget the women, we never hear about them, but the women and the men who were following the Jesus way. And in fact, for some time, early Christianity was simply called the way. It's a movement. It's not yet an institution, a movement that's going to be based on Peter's leadership. Maybe not personally, but certainly in that declaration he makes. And it's here in the city of Caesarea Philippi, the place of the Pan Rock and the gate of the underworld, that Jesus has this rock and gates of Hades conversation. Interesting, eh? Of course, it's not till 2 centuries later when the Roman Emperor Constantine has this declaration made that this following of Jesus is going to be Christianity, and it's going to be an institution. It's the state religion. And then, of course, it grows and it grows and its buildings grow, and gradually a lot of the pagan temples fall, which is why they're so surrounded in archaeological remains anymore. But in Jesus's day, he is talking about Peter the Rock in the very place known for the Pan Rock. He's saying the new way will take over the old way. Peter will become a new guy with a new identity, a new sense of purpose. I just love archaeology. It makes me think. It causes me to question. And we know in this congregation that we affirm questioning a lot. Because when I learn to question things, it takes me deeper and often makes old stories about Jesus come alive, like this one. And in that video of with Josh Gates, he ends up standing with an archaeologist right next to this large rock. And he knows the Bible story, and he knows the archaeology. And you can see him in the movie, in this episode, be visibly moved. Somehow, his new information and his new insights aren't just in his head anymore, and he's touched, not just by that information, but somewhere deeper. Maybe Josh Gates was beginning to feel new somewhere as well. Because this factual thinking stuff can indeed end up in a deeper place, and in the same place that that first question from Jesus came from. It takes us deeper, and it makes all of us, and this is where those of you who went off and stopped paying attention to me can come back in, because that question, who are you saying I am, meets right here. Because we all have to decide how we are going to articulate who Jesus is. Not who he was in some archaeological distant past. Who he is. Who do I think and feel and experience Jesus to be? When I'm listening, you're listening, we are listening to the chatter all around us about the role and impact of faith, especially these days, when there's a lot of chatter about Christians and politics, Jesus asks us, who are you saying I am? Now, for me, there's been a lot of different answers to that question in a lot of different stages in my life. And no one word or title or I can't get it into a cute little sudden thing like Peter could. Nothing, no one thing is enough. But it always comes down in some way or another to this. I am going to say that Jesus is the love of God come alive in a human being, which means that it's possible. This is what puts us all in the same uncomfortable place as our psalm question at the very beginning of worship. It had not been for God, then what? We have to be able to articulate what God means to us in an increasingly pagan and secular world. We have come full circle now. And for many people in the Western world, the church has a bad rep, and it has become the old way and needs to be renewed, probably because somehow or other we have forgotten that we're primarily a movement based on something very solid, but very difficult. And that's the rock of love. It's the rock of divine love. Whether we are call ourselves just people of faith, or whether you call yourself Christian or United Methodist, or, oh, I belong to Covenant, I know within me that our foundational rock here at Covenant is not necessarily the same as some Christians claim it to be. Because I don't always see the power of love and grace and justice that are really foundational to the Jesus way. Of course, as soon as I start saying that, it sounds judgmental, and I have to then look back at myself and say, well, Margaret, does the way you live look like love? This rock that can withstand the gates of hell that we are experiencing all over the world these days is the unashamed and very difficult rock of love. The only thing that works, to go back to that original Daily Reflections quote that I gave you at the beginning. So beginning today, may we pray to be changed as was Peter, to have a new identity, a new sense of purpose, a new way of being, to live in grace as did Jesus, so that divine love might work in us, fill us, and then little by little by little through us into this painful world. May it be so. Amen. God's love. We take our needs, our concerns, and our joys all to God in prayer. Remember we remember those people we've prayed for before, and a couple of new ones coming in. We're remembering Andy Scott's neighbor, Jim, who is having heart surgery tomorrow. Our own Kevin, who's doing great from eye surgery last week and is taking it on again this week. We pray for safe travels for Marvin and Dawn, who are very blessed to be traveling in God's own country, Scotland. And from online, from Marshawn, we are praying for his daughter, Stephanie, who's having bad migraines, Stephanie. If we really depended on God, said that quote earlier, we couldn't very well play God. And it's only a loving God who can give us inner peace. And so here we are, only in God alone. Let us pray. Alone, my soul can find rest and peace. In God, my peace and joy. Only in God, my soul can find its rest. Find its rest and peace. God of all our days and nights, we come in these quiet moments to rest in you. To seek peace in our troubled souls and joy in our hearts. Our lives get so distracted with trying to do it all ourselves, forgetting that peace and rest are most deeply found only in you. When our lives are too busy, grant us wisdom to slow down. World is in turmoil. Let us act and pray for peace. When we are moody and angry, remind us of your joy. When we are tired, let us rest our weary selves in you. We offer to you our worries about others, and we pray for all who grieve. For those who are ill in body, mind, or spirit. We pray especially for Jim as he faces heart surgery tomorrow, for healing for Stephanie, and continued healing and good results for Kevin. We pray for those who live in harm's way, whether in Ukraine, in all places of war, or in our homes and streets. We pray for world leaders, that they may have wisdom enough to work for peace instead of waging war. Peace enough in themselves to work for cooperation instead of fostering division. And joy enough to not take themselves too seriously. We offer you our deep gratitude for all the joys of life we experience, even when they seem infrequent or missing. For joy is deep within and found only in the love you continually offer. Help us take it as our foundational rock, the power of your love. We rejoice in and pray for safe travels for Marvin and Dawn. And all this we pray in your holy names, all your holy names, but daring to call you God of the cosmos, our Father. Our Father who art in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. As we enter our time of giving to God, we remind you that there are lots of ways that you can contribute financially and not financially to our ministry here at Covenant. Some of them are on our website. Some of them are right here in the pews. Some of them you can just use USPS and send us either a check or an offer to help in some of the ways in which we have engaged in ministry. We have some announcements while the ushers are taking up our offering. Reading on the Rock on Monday, don't forget that. We're having a lot of fun with that. This Monday, oh yes, it's me this Monday, yes. I'm reading one of my favorite Dr. Seuss books. Big lessons there. Covenant Table on Labor Day will be us serving a meal to our neighbors and friends. And you're all invited to come and have a meal. But you're especially invited to come early and help. So please see Bob today or call the church office during the week. I can't help. I believe it's hamburgers. Is that correct? Somebody nod their head. Yes? Okay. Thank you, Josh. Yes. So see Josh if you want to know detailed details. But yeah, it's Labor Day. You know, of course it's got to be hamburgers. Maybe hot dogs. I don't know. In great gratitude for all that we have been given, let us stand and praise God from whom all blessings flow. do praise you, O God, from whom all blessings flow, and offer you these gifts and ourselves, that your divine love may be powerful in this world, through us or in spite of us. Amen. I invite you to remain standing and sing our commitment hymn, I'm Gonna Live So God Can Use Me, but only sing it if you mean it. Benediction. As I think about what I want to benedict you with, good words, benedictos, good words to go out with. And what more can it be than that the power of love, divine love, goes with us? That we should live and work and pray and sing the song of the rock of love in our own lives first, and then sharing with everyone else. Go in love. As we hear the postlude, 'tis so sweet to trust in Jesus. People of God said, Amen.